Good evening. Welcome to the Monday, July 11th, 2016 Town Council meeting for the Town of Cape Elizabeth. Could I have the roll call, please?
Council Chair McCausland?
Here.
Council Garvin?
Here.
Council Grennan?
Here.
Council Jordan?
Here.
Council Lennon?
Here.
Council Ray?
Here.
And Council Sullivan?
Here. Thank you. Will you join me for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do we have any Town Council reports and correspondence tonight? Yes, Kayla?
I was just going to let everyone know we have an ordinance committee meeting Thursday here at the Jordan Conference Room at 1:30.
Thank you. Yes, Jay?
We also have a meeting on Friday morning at 8 o'clock at the Community Services Conference Room, different from our usual Thomas Memorial Library meeting room for the Spurwink School Reuse Committee. So that's at 8 o'clock in the morning on Friday. Conference room over at the Community Center.
Thank you. Anyone else? No? We'll move on. Finance Committee report. Mike, are you giving us an update tonight?
I would prefer to Kathy if she wants to say something first.
I have nothing to say.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to give an update. We're in the process of closing out the last fiscal year. Things, as you know, as we mentioned all along, look good. We actually, one of the council goals is to look at revenue, and we'll be getting a report next month on that, but we've begun to look at it. We took all the revenues, and it's interesting. If you look at all of the revenues from every fund, from every source, you know, including sewer fees, even Portland headlight sales, property taxes still make up 67.55% of our revenues. The next biggest revenue source is the state school subsidy, which is 8%. And then, interestingly enough, excise taxes and sewer fees, one was $2,063,618, and the other was $2,063,591, or a $27 difference out of almost $2.1 million between them, with excise taxes taking a little more. School lunch sales add up to a little over $600,000. The next biggest revenue for the town last year was library donations, $583,000. Of course, that was led by the library project from the Thomas Memorial Library Foundation. And the next item was Portland Headlight gift shop sales in that little garage down there at the lighthouse, $562,577 in that little two-car garage. So, you know, and if you go to by those amounts, that equals 90%, just those few things I mentioned, of all of our revenues. Everything else that we receive, from state revenue sharing to the pool revenues to the cable franchise fee, ambulance billing, all the community services revenues, all the miscellaneous Fort Williams fees, you know, everything only adds up to 10%. So it's an interesting little sort. Mm-hmm. If you look generally for taxes, which includes excise taxes and property taxes, that adds up to 73% of our revenue. We're very, very dependent on the property tax, and then secondly, the state school subsidy does help as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone have any questions or comments on that? No? Thank you, Michael. We'll move on to our next agenda item, which is citizen opportunity for discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there anyone here who'd like to speak? No? We'll move on. Town manager's monthly report. Michael, would you give us an update?
Yeah, just everything's going well. We've assumed responsibility for community services. The transition's gone fine. All the other departments are working well. The grass is growing a little bit again with a little bit of rain. But things look nice out there, getting ready for the beach to beacon. And things are relatively quiet.
Good. Thank you. Any questions for the manager? No? Thank you. Review of draft minutes of the June 13, 2016 meeting. I was not at that meeting, but I will be looking for a motion to accept those minutes. Yes, Jessica?
I move we accept the minutes of the June 13, 2016 meeting.
Thank you. Is there a second? Thank you, Sarah. Any discussion? Comments on those? No? All in favor? Opposed?
I'm going to abstain.
That passes.
I wasn't there either.
Right.
Oh, that's right.
Thanks, Kathy. Okay. Next up, we have a public hearing regarding proposed changes to board and commissions. I know there are some people in the audience who would like to speak tonight. Would we like to have an introduction to this item from the chair of the ordinance committee, and then we'll invite the public to speak?
The ordinance committee met several times to discuss the changes to the boards and commission ordinance. We ultimately did a lot of redrafting, recategorizing, so everything was structured in a more uniform way. We outlined everything and added in the committees that had not been put into the ordinance that were created years ago, such as the recycling committee. They're now a permanent committee on the ordinance committee, in the ordinance. We changed the names of all of the committees so that they were all uniform. We also made some changes in relocating some of the job descriptions of the Conservation Commission, so that would be in the Conservation Ordinance. There's a more, made more sense to place it there, as well as a few changes to the shooting, the firing range ordinance for the firing range committee makeup. Those are the bulk of the things you'll see in the ordinance changes, and then we had several recommendations go back to the town council for some further policy thoughts.
Okay, thank you. At this point, I will open the public hearing. If there are members of the public who would like to come up and address the council, please come up to the podium, give us your name, your address, your affiliation, if there's an affiliation that you'd like to identify, and if you could try to limit remarks to 3 minutes each, that would be appreciated.
Not by remarks. I'm Ruth Ann Haley, 49 Holly, oh, that's my old address, 49 Brentwood Road in Cape Elizabeth, and I am the chair of the Board of Trustees for the Thomas Memorial Library. This was presented to us a couple of meetings ago, I think in May, just sort of as a passing remark that, oh, by the way, all the commissions, boards, advisory councils, whatever, in town are now going to be called committees. And it was surprising to us because maybe we should follow all of the public meetings, but I didn't, obviously, and I was very disappointed that I hadn't been invited or made aware of this. I read through the minutes of the ordinance committee's meetings, and as they bumbled along, they finally kind of got on track after they figured out if this was legal, if they could do things that were in charter, in the bylaws, and apparently this board feels like they can change everything. And maybe that's okay, maybe as Merriam-Webster said, it's just a name. Doesn't matter if it's a committee or a board or a council. But for me, I would have appreciated a conversation, an awareness. I would have valued some input. All of the library boards in the state of Maine, I think, are called boards of trustees. So to be singled out in this way, and I may be wrong, there may be a few, but the state of Maine addresses us all as boards of trustees. So to be singled out like this is disappointing that we hadn't had a conversation ahead of time. So I just bring this to you along with a couple of concerns. eliminating the secretary so that the administrator, which is, I guess, the director of the library, would then take minutes. I don't think he's actually required to be at the meetings. He's the eighth member, non-voting member, and we advise each other, but I don't know if we have to have him. He's always there, but once in a while someone's sick or on vacation, so I would want to have that reviewed. And also, there's some things in the minutes. One thing that said, a little nervous here, so just bear with me. And this may be misread, and I have brought this up before to a council member. Another provision that should be looked at is the vacancies on the library trustees. Now, I'm thinking it might be the library foundation, because it says when the trustees make recommendation, all committee appointments should go through the town council appointments committee. So I'm not sure if that's an error or if it meant to say appointments to the foundation, but I think that needs to be clarified in the minutes. Another thing says, section 414, additional town council appointments. The town council designates itself to perform the duties of the following boards, and it includes the board of trustees. And maybe that was always there, but I would just like some clarification about some of these things as we go forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're giving me the nod.
Yes, Bobby. I am. Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak?
Good evening. I'm Debbie Peck, 21 Cottage Farms Road, and I, too, am on the Board of Trustees for the library. And I just had some questions, concerns that in reviewing minutes, some of the intentions of these changes. I'm concerned about eliminating the liaisons from attending committee meetings. I think that is a wonderful way for boards and committees to currently share information with what's going on in that area and for that to be able to come back to all of you. I'm concerned about decreasing the number of members on various committees. I'm concerned that the bigger picture of this is that I feel that what's being communicated is really looking at a way to limit public input in terms of what you do. And while that may make your jobs easier, I think it's really important that there are opportunities for public input and that that can happen in an organized fashion, which those two changes, I'm concerned that that really is taking away a lot of that intent. I'm also concerned about the name change. I've looked at libraries all over the state, and as Ruth Ann said, this is going to be a real change from what's going on around the rest of the state. I think it also diminishes the difference between different committees that you have in the town. There are some committees that meet once a year or meet quarterly. There are other committees or boards that meet monthly and are very involved in the work that's going on and the mission of those committees. So I would hope that you will look carefully at those issues and those concerns, because I think one of the strengths that we have in this community is that there are opportunities for a lot of public input, but it also feels that that there looks to be an intent to really start to minimize that or make it a little bit more difficult for the public to be able to share in an organized, meaningful manner information that's going on around the community. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is George Morris. I live at 1148 Shore Road. I'm vice president of the foundation, the Library Foundation. So The trick is I can't see you and see the paper at the same time. So I'm going to look at, just have a question basically about section 4-1-4, where it says the town council designates itself to perform the duties of the following boards. The membership and terms of these boards shall be the membership and terms of the town council. And then it lists the board of trustees of the Thomas Memorial Library. And I was wondering if, and initially I read that as the board of the foundation, but you're not doing anything with the foundation, is that correct? Yeah, okay. That was my question. The lobster was pretty good. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak? No? Seeing no one, I'll close the public meeting, public hearing, and we will return to item number 95-2016, proposed changes to ordinances regarding boards and commissions. Do we have a motion for discussion? Yes, Caitlin.
I'd like to move that we adopt the changes to the boards and commission ordinance as written.
Jessica?
I'll second.
Thank you. Discussion? Yes. Sarah?
I just would like to respond to what you said. I'm sorry. I'm horrible at names. But it's interesting to me that your takeaway from this was that we were trying to decrease citizen input and voice and increase council, because our conversation was just the opposite, that we were attempting to, I agree with you that part of what makes our community strong is the passionate citizens who get involved. And what we were trying to do was actually increase that, let's say, power or influence and decrease the council presence. That was the impetus behind suggesting that the that we not have liaisons, which isn't that part of our workshop conversation?
Yes,
so that's not
to be determined.
That's to be determined. But I'm very interested in your takeaway and that, and thank you, because I think that should be part of our workshop conversation. Because I agree with you 100% that in no way do we want to strengthen the council's presence and voice. We already have ample, in my opinion, and that I think a wide range of citizen voices that actually have some influence. And that's why we were saying, let's let these committees do their work, you know, leave them alone, don't have a counselor there telling them what to do and overseeing it once again. Let them be independent, do their work, and then come back and report to us. So the fact that your takeaway was the opposite is concerning to me, and I think that when we have a workshop on this, we should take a close look at that.
Thank you. Caitlin.
Just to address another comment that was made about the changing of the names and the different levels of committee work, I guess our thought was trying to have a uniform name across the board for all committees, because whether the committee works once a month or several times a month or twice a month, all work is equally important. And so we didn't want people feeling like they have a higher purpose because they're a trustee or a commission member. We went with committee because it seemed like just an easy across the board, everybody would have the same stature going forward, with whether you're on one committee or another committee or working with one group or another group. We wanted everyone to be on equal playing field. So we could have just as easily turned all of the committees into boards of trustees. It was, and not to take away from it, name is just a name, but that was really all we were thinking of, is a name is a consistent name across the board, so nobody felt like they had to do more. Or as a trustee, some people commented a lot of times in the appointments committee that they thought they had to do some financial thing towards the board that they were getting on. And so we wanted to eliminate any confusion moving forward. And I also made a note of what Sarah was just commenting about with the elimination of liaisons and decreasing the numbers. That is policy considerations for the town council to look at going forward. It has nothing to do with what's being adopted tonight, but we only brought those things up for the exact opposite of what's coming across. Apparently, we wanted more public input and less council input at these meetings. We wanted to hear more of what ideas you guys were generating on your own versus what the town council might be suggesting and then you running with that. So we wanted greater public input to coming back to us. So, thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Kathy?
A question probably for the ordinance committee group, but unless I'm misunderstanding, with the exception of the shooting range and the conservation committee, there's no change in the roles and responsibilities. We're just looking at a name change. Is that correct?
Right.
Thank you.
Can I ask for a little clarification on that? And this may be a question for the manager. I think if we look at this draft, repeal Chapter 4, Boards and Commission replacement document, and someone in the public commented on this, Section 4-1-4, additional town council appointments. So we now will have a Thomas Memorial Library Board of Trustees, just as we do with the Museum of Portland Headlight, that is comprised of the town council. And then we will also have a committee for the Thomas Memorial Library. So I'm looking for a little clarification on what the difference is between the roles and responsibilities. So I understand what the roles and responsibilities are proposed to be for the committee based on this document. What would the council / Board of Trustees responsibilities be, and how would they be separate?
Do me a try. My understanding is that it is in the town charter that, and anybody jump in if I get this synchronized wrong. In the town charter, it lists that a board of trustees there will be a board of trustees for the library. It is very difficult to change the wording in a town charter. So in order to have all the committees uniformly named committee, we are going to name the town council as the board of trustees. They have basically no responsibilities and have no oversight of anything but be called the name so that we don't have to have a town charter change. And then the library committee will be the library committee that has all the same responsibilities and all the same duties, and everything is the same as when they were the board of trustees. They're just now called the committee. And then the note in there that brings in the foundation part was because the library foundation, their rules state that there will be a town councilor on their foundation as well as two members of the board of trustees. But now with us being technically named the board of trustees, that would give three councilors onto the foundation. So we are to request that the foundation change their rules to ask for one councilor and two committee members. So it goes back to being one councilor and two members from the library committee. Does
I'm with you.
Kind of follow that?
Yes. Thank you.
Do you have something to add?
Jessica?
Yeah, it would function the same way it already does with Riverside Memorial Cemetery, the Thomas Jordan Trust, the entire council of the trustees, but then there are separate committees that carry out the duties. So it would be the same. It's the same situation, and we already have precedents for that in other committees.
Mm-hmm.
So,
okay. Thank you. Other questions?
I have comments.
Yeah.
And I want to thank the councilor for clearing up. I think Ruth Ann and Debbie came forth, and as well Mr. Morris, to talk about what these changes would potentially mean for them were really good questions. And I think so far the council has, I think, addressed them to hopefully ease some of the thoughts around that. I do want to speak to Ruth Ann, a letter that we got from Ruth Ann earlier today, and as well from Ken Piper from the foundation. And the first thing is, in a letter that we got from you, and we didn't hear this tonight, is that Ruth Ann, that the board of trustees, the trustees felt that there was a real kind of disrespect for the good work that has been done. And I guess I would be able to, I know for a fact that all of us as counselors, I probably can speak on behalf of you to say that
we so appreciate all the work that the trustees do for the library. We know that you are really in there, you know, day after day. You were so responsible for all that was done with our opening, and I want to know, I think, on behalf of the town council, we do value the volunteers in this town, and regret that you didn't feel that way. Secondly, while I agree with, I think that we talked about the roles and responsibilities, with reading this, I read that we will not have, stating that the duties haven't changed. So although we are changing the name potentially, the duties and roles and responsibilities wouldn't be changing. When Ken Piper wrote a letter, he talked about nomenclature and how that affects kind of the community of being trustees. And he wrote how that was important. And I guess I would kind of agree with that. I feel like this is one case that's different than other committees and boards in our town, where I think that the trustees are generally known across the state and the country as being trustees. So to me, I feel like knowing that the Board of Trustees, it's important to them, I would like to make an amendment to the motion and to exempt the Thomas Memorial Library Board of Trustees from the proposed board and committee ordinance change.
Thank you. Do we have a second for that?
I'll second it.
Thank you, Sarah. Discussion about that? Yes, Jessica?
I won't be supporting that amendment. I don't think I appreciate the sentiment behind it. We are making another change to another committee, the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. We are taking away the word commission and changing it to committee. I don't see that the Thomas Memorial Library Trustees as a committee, as one of the standing committees in town, are any more or any less vital to the town's functions. We have other committees that are as important. Commission is a word that can be construed to denote authority, as can a trustee. And what we are trying to promote is present is a change in terminology so that we can actually encourage more involvement. For example, for those of us that have served on the appointments committee, we have had situations where applicants have been very reluctant or concerned that they would have a financial responsibility if they are a trustee. Some folks are worry about functioning at too high of a level on some of the committees, and these committees are all advisory, and we have many volunteers who feel, gee, I want to be advisory, I'm not sure that I want to take on all these other roles, and there can be at times an amount of confusion about this. I don't think it's necessary to amend this, I would point to the same example with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. That is a big change. We have had no one from that committee here, and I think that change is of equal effect, I guess, if you will. And I don't think the amendment's necessary.
Thank you.
I was just going to comment the same for the Conservation Commission. I mean, it's statewide usually referred to as a commission, and you know, we changed their name to the Conservation Committee as well, just for the same purposes that Jessica just spoke to. You know, we're not picking on the Board of Trustees of the library. We wanted to uniform the terminology used within this town for all of our volunteers that work so hard, whether you're a board of trustees on the library or you're meeting for the Riverside Cemetery when you need to, hopefully not very often. But it's just to put everybody on the same terminology.
Thank you. Any other comments? Yes, Kathy.
I'm not going to support the amendment because I like the consistency of having everybody be a committee. And I did a little bit of research because I saw the reference to trustees, and I looked up some of the other libraries in the state. I'm not saying this is true for all of them, but some of the trustees, library trustees, and some of the other libraries have different roles and responsibilities. So I'm not sure that necessarily is a valid argument that they should be trustees versus a committee. So I like the consistency. I think it needs to be clear that a committee is a committee of the council. And there's no change in roles and responsibilities. I will also support the Fort Williams Advisory Commission being changed to a committee. I think it's important that we're clear. And so for me, I will support the Ordinance Committee's proposal.
Thank you. Sarah?
No.
No? I thought you had your hand raised. No?
I guess what I feel is that we've got a group here who want to remain trustees. And while I would say that it makes sense to have it all be the same, we have, if you lay down the roles, responsibilities, and you lay out the fact that there is no contribution financially, and you could put that in the document really easily, it just would seem like it would make sense to leave this one particular group as trustees, as that is their wishes, and the fact that we've all agreed that the roles and responsibilities haven't changed, and in fact they are advisory to the council. So I just will, that would be my last final statement.
Thank you. Any other discussion on that? Yes, Jessica.
To Councilor Ray's point, there are boards of trustees and libraries throughout the state that, as Councilor Ray was pointing out, are trustees of very different organizations. Many of these libraries are private, quasi-private. This library is completely public, like all our other entities and committees in town. So I think that that needs to be remembered, and I would also add that along with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, the Conservation Commission, these committees are all of equal importance. They all have volunteers that work equally hard. And I don't think that there's anything here that needs to be singled out and accepted.
Thank you. Anyone else? No? All in favor of the amendment to the motion? Opposed? That does not pass. Did you get that count on that? Great. Thank you. We will move back to the original motion. More discussion?
I just have one question to Mike about what Ruth Ann had said at first about us eliminating the secretary. We're not trying to eliminate the role of the secretary, but you said that staff members are required to go to the meetings or not?
It's expected that every committee will receive staff assistance, yes.
That's what we thought.
But there are going to be times that, maybe someone's on vacation, whatever, they can still meet, but the general expectation is that the assigned staff person attend each meeting of the committee.
And so just to expand on the rationale of eliminating the role of the secretary and moving it to the staff member, we had several people give us feedback that it's very difficult to be a very active member of the committee while trying to take well-maintained minutes of the meeting. So this is to encourage, again, more public participation from the committee members so that they're not having to, totally miss the whole conversation, not getting to give any input themselves because they're trying to catch what she just said and what he just said and make sure that everything gets recorded well. So that's why we decided to assign that job for all committees to a staff person so that the public members of the committee can have their chance to talk at every instance they would like.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions?
I just wanted to make one other comment. There've been some controversy about the firing range committee and its makeup and the fact that it had representatives from the Rod and Gun Club and specifically from the neighborhood. And I just wanted to point out that the recommendation that's being considered does away with those set positions, and instead it simply says the committee would be composed of 5 members appointed by the town council in accordance with its appointments procedure. So that is a change, and it is intended to remove what many people thought were conflicts of interest.
Yes.
Kate. Just to point out, so that will mean going forward that the appointments committee is going to have to fill the firing range committee rather quickly, because all of the old committee members will no longer be on the committee, I would imagine, is how we would move forward, because as a town councillor being on it, I no longer am a member of the public that would be wanting to be on that committee. So we'll have a new firing range committee moving forward after this evening, I would hope.
Very quick question.
Yes.
It was my understanding that the shooting range ordinance is not complete, and that is one of the things we're going to consider in a workshop, is that correct? I think the language needs some polishing up, and we need a final decision on the number in the committee.
Before we hold our vote on Caitlin's motion, I'm going to ask Deb if she will read it back to us. We don't need to do that quite yet, but I do have a concern about what your exact motion was and whether we're separating that from page 2 of the memorandum, which lists 5 companion recommendations, and I think perhaps that's what you're referring to, Sarah, that those items perhaps might need to go to workshop.
I think that happened at the last council meeting. It was referred to the workshop.
Yeah.
Oh, it was.
Those items were already referred to the workshop.
The recommendations are already going to workshop, but the way it's written right now, the firing range committee would have 5 members appointed as whoever, you know, applies and comes and interviews, and the appointments committee appoints them, as it's written now,
right,
that we'd be voting on tonight for an ordinance change.
Okay. I have a follow-up question to that, and that is, I think that the way the language is written right now says that we are asking that committee comprised of 5 citizens to inspect the firing ranges. Are we going to revisit that when we revisit the whole ordinance, or have you had that conversation already?
It was very difficult because we need the town council to send the firing range, the shooting range ordinance for revision to the ordinance committee.
Mm-hmm.
So the best that we could do was touch on the membership, because that dealt directly with the firing range, with the boards and commission,
right,
that we were doing. And then we did not touch the duties and responsibilities in the shooting range ordinance, but tried to get the duties and responsibilities in the boards and commission ordinance that we felt would be what was most likely to be moving forward.
So your
language
expectation is that your 5-person citizen comprised committee will be inspecting the shooting range, is that correct?
Can I weigh in?
I need the,
it was, in here.
Yes, exactly, and I think what it says is, on section part number 3, duties, firing range committee shall have the following duties: review license applications and inspect firing ranges in accordance with the shooting range ordinance, chapter 24.
That's what it says in the shooting range ordinance.
But have we not pulled that out of this conversation and vote tonight, because we were very clear that we, there were too many questions and unknowns for, we need to have a workshop on this for the language, in my opinion, and that's what we talked about in the ordinance right committee. We need the council as a whole to weigh in on some important issues. I think that's one of them.
Thank you.
The problem was going forward from the boards and commission ordinance perspective, was we talked a lot about how to get those in. And so we said, all we're going to do is take the language that is in the firing range ordinance, right, or shooting range ordinance, and then it's the firing range committee. Sorry, it gets confusing because they have different names.
Right.
The shooting range ordinance, we took straight from that and put that into the boards and commissions, because to try and change the language and then go back and see if we could change the language to what the shooting range ordinance was would be confusing. So we had to only put in what is written as of now, as if nothing is going to change. But yes, I do believe that the shooting range ordinance will need to be reformed by the ordinance committee. And when that's done, it might change the duties and responsibilities of the firing range committee under the boards and commission ordinance. So once the ordinance committee is done working on the shooting range ordinance, we might have to make an amendment to the boards and commission
ordinance. Thank you.
Of the duties and responsibilities of the firing range committee.
You anticipated my question. Thank you. That's great.
I think that is how it needs to work.
So I would suggest that you someone add to the motion to refer a review of the shooting range ordinance to the ordinance committee.
Is there someone
so moved?
Thank you. Is there a second for that? Yes, Jessica?
Yes.
Thank you. Discussion about that? No? All in favor of that amendment? Any opposed? No? That passes unanimously. Thank you. Good suggestion. Jessica, did you have another comment you wanted to make?
Well, I was just going to just kind of rephrase and affirm what Councilor Jordan said. The only thing, the only change we made was the composition of the committee, of the firing range committee. We brought some language forward that already exists to give it something in this proposed new chapter, knowing full well the council would, has planned and has already discussed publicly in a complete review of the shooting range ordinance.
Right. And then we would revisit, as you just said, the job description in here after that work has been done.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Do you have ever read Becky Whitman's?
She hasn't yet.
Motion that you asked for?
I asked her to wait until we're ready to vote. Any other comments? No? Any other discussion? We're done. Okay, now Deb, would you read that back to us?
Okay. The, you're going back to an original motion as amended to adopt the repeal of Chapter 4 in its draft, in addition referring the shooting range ordinance to the ordinance committee.
With the
changes to the shooting range ordinance as well as the conservation ordinance. That is also included in the motion.
Would you like to amend your motion or?
Do you want me to try and restate the motion?
Yes.
Okay, so my original motion was that we are going to adopt the new boards and commission ordinance as well as the changes made to the shooting range ordinance and the conservation ordinance. Because those two other ordinances have little tweaks. And now we've also added the amended part of referring the shooting range ordinance to the ordinance committee for review and revision.
Okay. All in favor? Any opposed? No. Wonderful. That also passes unanimously.
So much easier than just doing this.
Thank you, Caitlin. We'll move on to item number 96-2016, the proposed technical amendments. And Michael, will you give us an introduction to this item?
Yes, I'm happy to. I'm actually speaking for the planning board this evening.
Yes.
Since this is just a referral to the ordinance committee, we decided that maybe they could take a summer night off. But anyway, the council had asked the planning board to look at some technical amendments to some of our various ordinances. This is sort of the last piece that comes out of the last comprehensive plan that hadn't been dealt with. And these are technical amendments to the subdivision ordinance, the zoning ordinance, the conservation ordinance, and a new Chapter 25 stormwater ordinance. The planning board met 11 different times on this. They held a public hearing on June 21st. And it has everything to do with performance guarantees, inspection fee amounts, provisions involving record drawings, a stormwater maintenance plan, refinement of tree requirements, the planting list of trees to be planted, minimum lot size, a DEP definition, the moderate income definition, so that we won't run into the problem we ran into with Eastman Meadows, the structure definition, in it, I go on and on, bullet headings. You know, they've spent a lot of time on this, and I think the ordinance committee will enjoy beginning to review this at the next meeting.
Yes.
Is that it?
That's it.
Thank you. So
it's all online. All
yes.
All the everything's online. Everything
many,
I was
many
reading
pages.
From.
And I would like to thank the planning board and staff for their hard work on that, and I will be looking for a motion to refer the planning board proposals to the ordinance committee for review and for recommendation back to the council. Jessica?
I so move.
Thank you. Second?
Second it.
Thank you, Caitlin. Any discussion about that? No? All in favor? Opposed? No? Passes unanimously. Thank you. We will move on to item number 97, pickleball and tennis. Michael? you'll introduce that item?
Yes, pickleball and tennis. There's pickleball, I've never played, but I understand it's very popular with some folks, and we get into some conflicts during last season between the tennis ball players and the pickleball players, and the council set up a ad hoc committee made up of representatives of the Community Services Advisory Commission and the Portland Advisory Commission to look at the issue, and they came up with some compromise recommendations, or some, I could say, some facilitating recommendations that will allow both groups to live in harmony and to provide the service to both parties. And so what you have before you is the recommendation from that committee. And, you know, I think we would look at, you know, the first four bullets as sort of a pilot for this year to see how it works out. And, you know, with the understanding that if it doesn't work out, we'll come back with other issues. And then longer term, we want to be looking at the capital improvement plan to see if maybe there's some place we could accommodate pickleball on some new or different facility. So I would encourage the council to adopt the recommendations of the pickleball slash tennis ad hoc committee, and with the understanding that the first four bullets are a one-year pilot.
Thank you. Great introduction. Could I have a motion? Patty?
Sure. I'll move to approve the pickleball committee short-term solutions.
Thank you. Is there a second for that?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion?
Isn't there also a suggested long-term solution? Is that separate? Are we looking at that separately?
There's, did you want to?
I just thought that Mike said that we would look at as part of a capital improvement and down the road. So do we need to include it now, or do you want to?
You know, you depend on the town manager's capital improvement plan, so I think you could refer that recommendation to the town manager for consideration in the capital stewardship plan.
Okay, so I'll amend my motion to refer the long-term solutions to the town manager for a capital improvement stewardship plan and analysis.
Thank you. Just point of order, that's a restatement of a motion, correct? Not not an amendment to
totally
a motion.
Up to the chair.
I'm going to take that as a restatement of
okay.
the motion. Thank you. And we have a second. Thank you, Sarah. Now, any discussion about that? Yes, Jessica.
Yep. I can't remember if the town manager just mentioned this, but the ad hoc committee had members of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. This issue came to the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. Mm-hmm. And so members of that soon-to-be committee and our commission volunteered to get together with members of the tennis community and the pickleball community to collaboratively come up with some solutions. So they did a very good job. Mm-hmm. So I just want to point that out.
I also want to thank our newest town department head, Russell Pickett, for staffing at ad hoc.
Oh, that's great.
Bissell Pickettball?
That's good.
Bissell Pickettball.
Great. Any other discussion on that item? No? All in favor? Any opposed? No? Passes unanimously. We will move on to item number 98-2016, Cape Elizabeth Land Trust request for donation to assist in the purchase of the Glue property near Jewett Road. I know we have some folks from the Land Trust here tonight. Michael, maybe I could ask you to introduce the item, and then if there are folks who would like to speak, we'll
I'd be happy to. At the last town council meeting, town council conditionally approved a $75,000 gift to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust to purchase what is known as the Glue property that's down off Lattice Road, down off Jewett Road, adjacent to Great Pond. The approval was conditioned upon the town attorney and the Land Trust coming up with terminology to bring about the effect of preserving the land and looking at after the town's interest in the property. So what happened is there was a document called a declaration that was developed that you have in your packets and before you. There's both parties agree on the language of the declaration. There is then an accompanying public access easement, and both parties agree on just about every provision there, with the exception of one key provision. And you have before you two versions. One of which, at the top, they both say public access easement, but in the the authorship section. One says R. Danielson, 7/8/16, that's the land trust last proposal, and then T. Leahy, Tom Leahy, the town attorney, 7/8/16, that was the town attorney's last proposal, and we've put forward your both proposals. The difference is that the land trust proposal says that in the event that a decision can't be made on four issues, creating or locating trails, design standards for construction, including boardwalks and bridges, to adopt use restrictions as would have a material impact on public access, and to transfer a grant real estate interest in some or all premises to third parties, it says shall be made jointly by the parties. And the town's thing is that it would be made jointly by both parties. And the land trust provision has some additional language. In the event that a decision cannot be reached by the town and the land trust in its capacity as landowner retains the final authority to approve any such project. So that is essentially the issue of disagreement. You have both before you, and as Tom, you know, indicated in his email transmitting this, at this point it's really a policy decision as to what direction you wish to go in this.
Thank you. I think I need a motion in order to begin the discussion, and then if I could have a motion, then I will invite the public to speak. Do I have a motion on this item?
Sure.
Caitlin.
I'll move that we accept the land trust's draft of the declaration note of the public access easement.
Thank you. Second? Thank you, Jamie. Okay.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that, Caitlin?
I said that we accept the land trust version of the public access easement.
And is that enough of a motion, even though all this language has to do with our donation and blah, blah, blah?
So,
or are we dividing this into two parts?
Well, my understanding is that the motion last month was that we conditionally approved the use based on the acceptance of.
Thank you. You're right.
I need clarification.
Just if I might, I think what Councilor Jordan has moved is that the council approve the proposed declaration, and that they also approve the public access easement, being the draft of R. Danielson on 7/8/16.
And I need clarification then. Do we also need to approve the $75,000 donation?
It was conditional upon you doing this other action.
Okay.
So if you approve an agreement, then that becomes enforced because the condition has been met.
Okay, thank you. At this point, do we have members? I see we have a couple of people from the land trust. Would you, either one of you, like to come up and speak to the council?
Good evening. My name is Ann Carney. I live at 21 Angel Point Road, and I'm also the president of the board of the land trust. First of all, I want to start by thanking everyone for all the time and energy and thoughtfulness that the town has spent on considering the donation and the public access easement for the glue property, which we're calling Great Pond Preserve 2, even though that's a mouthful. I see that there's a member of the Conservation Commission here, and I know the town manager and the town planner have worked very hard on this as well. The council has two draft easements, and I understand that the motion is to approve the easement that gives the land trust decision-making authority in the event that the parties aren't able to agree on a stewardship issue. So I'll address that, but before I get to that, I want to talk just generally about the benefits that the town receives from the collaboration with the land trust on acquisition of this property. Under the conservation, the public access easement, the town, by donating less than 25% of the cost of the property, gets joint decision making on projects, and this is reading from the public access easement itself, projects with regard to the premises that pertain to public access. And that includes creating, locating, and relocating trails, implementing design standards for trail construction, boardwalks, and bridges. It includes adopting use restrictions that would have any material impact on public access, and joint decision-making on the transfer or granting of any real estate interests in the property to third parties. In addition to all of that shared and joint decision-making, and I think that this is a great benefit for all of the citizens of the town, the land trust under the public access easement agrees to be responsible for, quote, construction, financing, and completion of all projects agreed to by the party. So I think that that addresses both public access needs and is very fiscally responsible on the part of the town. Let's see. I just want to address briefly the point of disagreement between the two drafts that were included in your board packets tonight. And that addresses how stewardship issues are resolved if the parties can't, as the easement requires, resolve an issue through good faith negotiations. Now, just to address this for a minute, the land trust believes wholeheartedly that we're going to be able to resolve issues with the town through good faith negotiations. We're not thinking about disagreements that are going to happen as we implement trail construction improvement on the property in the near future. But as a land trust and a nonprofit organization, we have an obligation under state and federal laws and regulations and under our own articles of incorporation and bylaws to preserve land in perpetuity. So when we look at a document like this public access easement, we're not just looking at how it's going to work in the next 5 or 10 years, where many of us still may be involved in the town and the land trust, but we need to look 50 years, 100 years, 500 years out. And so when we look at a document that conveys an interest in a land that the land trust owns in fee, we have to say, is this document going to work in 50 years? Is it practical and effective to protect the conservation values of the property 500 years from now? And for that reason, it's very important to the land trust, and I appreciate the motion currently before the council, that the land trust, in the event that there's a disagreement, has the final decision-making authority. And again, it has nothing to do with any concerns about the current folks at the table or even future members of the town council. But I think 100 or 500 years from now, the town faces a lot of competing pressures, fiscal pressures, pressures related to the school system, public safety, and I know you all deal with those on a daily basis. The land trust, I think of it, we only wear one hat. We're a conservation organization, and that's our area of expertise. In addition, we're funding 75% of the property, and so we feel like when we look at this public access easement, it makes sense, it's appropriate, and it's really kind of who we are as an organization, that we need to retain final decision-making authority over the next 5 or 10 centuries, however long there's going to be a Cape Elizabeth and a Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. We just need to retain that decision-making authority, and so thank you for your motion and thank you for your support. I'm happy to answer any questions. I know that Cindy also has some comments.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Cindy Crum, and I am here not as a resident, but as a representative of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust at 330 Ocean House Road, right next door. And I don't want to repeat any of the things Anne said too much, but I do want to, again, really thank you for taking so much time to consider this, and thank you for your motion a month ago in support of the acquisition. We really, really appreciate that step towards working together, which you have done many times in the past as well. And also wanted to say that the two documents in front of you absolutely take care of two of the concerns that I know people have had, which are they definitely ensure public access on the property, and they definitely ensure the conservation values of the property. So like we've all been saying, it kind of comes down to the one issue more about final decision making. And I will say that in my short tenure here as executive director of the Land Trust, it has definitely been one of my goals to step in and work more closely with the town. And, you know, I would really work with the board and with, you know, the Conservation Commission or whatever committee the town wanted us to work with to make sure that we were communicating about a property. I think it's a really great opportunity to step forward in yet a new way of collaboration. And I know that the Land Trust is really behind that. But for the reasons that I think Anne already laid out really, really well, we do feel that we need that one sentence in the public access easement. So if, you know, we weren't to agree that we have that protection as an organization that has to hold up certain articles of incorporation, et cetera. So I too appreciate the motion that's on the table. I will say that we've already started collaborating with the Conservation Committee. We're relocating a trail. I just got the DEP permit last week over at Robinson Woods, and it was one that they had really hoped would be in a slightly different place. So now I just need to take the step to get the town permit for that. And, you know, we are taking steps in that direction. So certainly it is our intent to continue to do that. And I thank you for considering the motion that's on the table.
Thank you. Are there other members of the public or the Conservation Commission who would like to speak? No? Okay. Discussion, Kathy.
I have two items. First of all, on the document, Declaration of Covenants and Restrictions, Section 1, Item D, I would like to find out what exactly that means. Declarant may allow permissive use of the existing farm track by motorized farm vehicles for agricultural purposes. Can somebody explain what that is?
Yes, please, come right up. Thank you.
Yeah, we had the property surveyed, and we learned that it was actually nearly 23 acres instead of nearly 21 acres. But as part of the survey, it came to the surveyor's attention that there's like a two-rut track that goes from Alewife Farm down from an upper part down to a lower part. And that's been used for many years, I suppose. But the we don't have any intention to discontinue that use any more than we have any intention to discontinue the use by the neighbors along Gladys, who have set up their own informal trail network. And it was just, that sentence was in there because unlike the neighborhood use where it's all foot traffic, that would be motor vehicle traffic, and motor vehicles aren't allowed on the property other than for maintenance and emergency. And so that's just, it's just because it's a qualifier to the motor vehicle language.
Thank you. Madam Chair, I would suggest that maybe we have a conflict of interest for Councilor Jordan.
Yes, Caitlin, speak to that.
Certainly. The trail that goes down across my parents' property down into the field, we did meet with the Land Trust, and it has no financial benefit to the farm at all. We can relocate the trail just like it's like 20 feet over, but the Land Trust, just being good neighbors, said that it would be fine if you still hook around two trees instead of going and cutting the trees down and putting in a different access point, which anybody's welcome to come down and you can see that it literally is just a little hook on a corner. So, and we told the Land Trust when we met with them that if it was a problem, that it wasn't that hard for us to just start a new road. But it had been a road there before it became Alewife Brook Farm, when it was People's Farm. It's just how the farm road has always been. So I did not feel, I disclosed at the last meeting that I was a neighbor of the property, and I felt as though this was in no way any financial benefit, no fiduciary interest in any way that, you know, a tractor can drive on a tiny piece of track in the corner of the property. They can just as easily come out if it's a problem.
Yes, did you want to speak to that?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that it is permissive use that could be revoked at any time. I don't know if that makes a difference.
Thank you. Yes. And Caitlin, just so I'm clear, what you're saying is that this track on this proposed Land Trust property is being used by you right now, but if this were taken out of the agreement, you would have access on your own property to get to wherever it is that you're getting to.
And that's what I was saying, literally, I did a lovely map of the tax assessor's map, and all it is you go down through our, across our property, and when you turn a corner to go down, because it's a square, right, you turn the corner, you go a few feet onto the glue property, and then you come back onto our property, so that you hook around two trees. The road can easily be changed to hook through those trees or come in front of those trees. It in no way affects our access other than it's an existing farm road.
Okay. Yes, Sarah?
Just one more question. So essentially what you're saying is there's no change in use in regards to this. They're not offering anything more different. It's just how it's always been, and it will continue to be that way. So there's no benefit to you.
There's no benefit.
It's just status quo.
Right. And if it's, and like, if you want to take it out tonight, you can take it out tonight. It makes no difference to the farm. It in no way affects us other than we don't have to move the road. And which, when it's a farm road, you just drive down the new hill. It's not that difficult.
So to me, that doesn't rise to the level of recusal.
So, I have another question, but back to that, I would suggest that either it has to come out in order for Caitlin to vote on it, or if it stays in, Caitlin needs to recuse herself.
Okay.
That's my opinion, and I think we should deal with that issue before we move on.
Okay.
So.
Would you like to make a motion which would be an amendment to the motion that is on the table right now?
No, we have to vote on whether to she recuses
yeah,
herself.
Yeah, we need
well,
to.
Well, either to. We vote on her recusal or we amend the motion on the...
Well, I have other problems with the motion, so I...
You'd like to vote on the recusal?
I would like to deal with, because I think when a conflict is brought up, you're meant to stop everything and deal with the conflict. So I think we need to deal with that first, and then we can move on to the rest of it, unless I'm wrong and Michael or somebody can correct me.
Councilor Ray is correct. This would be, I think, technically a point of order, and as such needs to be dealt with in the moment, regardless of what other prior amendments are on the table.
So, are you making a motion, Kathy?
I don't think I have to, do I, or do I?
I don't
have to
know.
Make a motion for Caitlin to
right.
recuse herself.
Okay. Then, if I understand Caitlin correctly, she said it doesn't matter if they can use that track. Is that correct?
Right. There's no financial benefit.
Then the next question is, does it matter to the land trust if it comes in or out? If that piece is removed from, no.
They said it didn't matter.
It doesn't matter. So
right.
then, I don't know. Jessica, did you want to add something? You look like you were, I think
well,
you could use some help.
Questions. Well, I have a couple of questions.
So I'm confused. What you just said to me was, as a point of order, we need to deal with the recusal. Mm-hmm. So I think we either need to have a motion for the recusal or we need to have a motion, as you suggested, Kathy, as the alternative, to take that language out of the motion that's on the table right now, one or the other.
Is that correct, Michael?
Yeah. Usually when there's a point of order and it involves a conflict of interest, although it's not usually done by a point of order, but I'm hearing that's the way the council wishes to do it. You know, it doesn't require a motion. The council needs to make a determination. What's traditionally done is the person who is the subject explains their conflict or their potential conflict. Then the council, there isn't a motion. There's simply, do we recuse or not? And there's a vote.
Do we recuse or not?
Excuse me?
So I think we're at do we recuse or not.
Okay. Jessica,
well,
comment?
I'm not ready because I have questions directly concerning this issue.
I do as well. So why don't you ask your question if it has direct bearing on the issue of recusal or conflict of interest?
It does.
Okay.
And I would like to ask either the attorney or the representative of the land trust. question?
Please.
Related to this?
I'm sorry, well, the president, I'm sorry, yeah.
I mean, I know you're an attorney, you know, I mean, your name's, so.
You know, in reviewing D in your declaration and then looking at that, and then jumping on to the public access easement that you are proposing that has the language that was just discussed.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to review point number four, that paragraph near the bottom, beginning, the parties shall jointly identify and develop projects.
Let me just grab that.
It's on the front page, I know it's.
Yep. Okay, I've got it, yep.
Yep. So that, again, that paragraph begins, the parties shall jointly identify and develop projects, and mm-hmm. goes on. I'm interested in point number four, where it reads, to transfer or grant real estate interests in some or all of the premises to third parties shall be made jointly by the parties, provided that other than customary maintenance costs, grantor shall not be required to make any financial contribution for any project which it has not approved. And so, thinking about the discussion we've just been having, mm-hmm. and granting interests in some or all of the premises to third parties,
mm-hmm.
my question is there anything that you are contemplating with abutters, neighbors, or other entities?
No, that clause four surprised us very much. It's something that the town attorney proposed kind of at the very last minute on Friday, and we don't have any intent to transfer the property because we're a conservation organization, so we retain it in perpetuity and protect its conservation values forever. So I don't know why that phrase is there, but we didn't object to it because we were working hard to come to an agreement with the town. So I can't explain why it's there.
So you are not planning at this point in time to grant easements to any other entities for any
no.
other reason?
No.
Other than the town?
Correct.
In this, through this document?
Correct. And so I would say if you object to that number four, we don't mind taking it out. We also are fine leaving it in. It's up to you.
Personally, I don't object. I just was wondering if you have are in discussion or contemplating granting easements.
No, we were surprised by that.
Okay.
Did you have another question?
Well, no, I have another comment. I know Councilor Jordan has stated several times that she has or doesn't deem any financial benefit, but financial benefit is not the only issue revolving a conflict of interest concern. It can be a perception of something, and even if it's a practical benefit, there still may be a conflict of interest or perceived conflict of interest. And so I think this is worth reviewing, because given that we are voting on $75,000 of taxpayer money to give to the land trust, I think this is, you know, worthy of our serious consideration.
Thank you. Any other comments or discussion on that? So I will just say that we'll take a vote in just a minute on the possible recusal. My personal preference is going to be that we do not ask you to recuse, but that we do take out this reference to the farm track on the land trust property. So having said that, yes, Patty, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I guess I would say if they did that, though, if your personal preference is to do that, would they, the Jordan family be able to use that?
With the what?
Would the Jordan family be able to use that little bit of an access, or would they have to?
They would move it on to their own property.
Based on pulling it out.
Right. So all in favor of asking Councillor Jordan to recuse herself
for the as written?
As written. Opposed?
I don't even know if I can tell.
That does not pass. So now I think we need to come back and have the conversation about taking out that reference to the farm track. And I think, Kathy, it was you who brought that issue up, so I'll ask you if you'd like to revisit it.
Yeah, I mean, since the council did not support Caitlin's recusal, then my next suggestion or request would be to take Section D out. But I'm not going to make a new motion in total, because I have a problem with the public access easement.
Okay.
As proposed by Mr. Danielson.
So right now, we have a motion on the table from Caitlin to accept the land trust declaration and easement. And Kathy, if I'm hearing you correctly, you would like to amend that motion to remove paragraph 1D of the restrictions and reserve rights of the Declaration of Covenants and Restrictions document. Is that correct? That's the reference to declarant may allow permissive use of the existing farm tract by motorized farm vehicles for agricultural purpose.
I'll be happy to make a motion that just adopts the declaration, but leaves out the public access easement, because I have a problem with that. So
yes.
I do not want to amend the original motion, because that would assume that I agree with the public access easement, unless you want me to take that out as well, which I can do. My motion would be to remove Section D.
Yes.
And adopt the public access easement as proposed by Tom Leahy alone. The council's, the one that he has proposed to the council.
But can't we have a conversation about the motion on the table?
That's what I'm asking.
We are having that conversation, and we're talking about amending that. And Kathy, I will just say my only concern with doing that is I'm anticipating we're going to have yet another amendment.
Yes.
If we accept your amendment in the form that you're proposing making it, because...
Well, that's why I'm saying I think we should just deal with the two documents separately.
So
I don't know if we can do that, but that's my motion would be to remove Section D, Section 1D out of the Declaration of Covenants and not deal with the public access easement.
And deal with that separately.
Deal with that separately.
Okay.
So that would be my motion.
Okay. Do I have a second for that motion?
I don't even know it's being moved.
Yeah.
What are you saying?
Okay.
I'm saying this particular
that
document
thought.
Here.
Yeah.
I'm asking that, saying that we approve that with the removal of this item, but not deal with these.
So we're talking about the motion on the table, and all you want to do is make an amendment that removes D?
No.
Right
no.
now?
No.
But that would be the easiest way to go.
Yeah. Amend the motion to get rid of D, and then we can vote on the amendment. Could you vote on the amendment, and then, so we can do it, no?
No. I think right now we have a motion on the table from Caitlin that says, accept the land trust declaration and easement as proposed by the land trust.
Correct.
So do you want to finish discussing that?
I think we should.
No amendments, is that what you're saying?
Yeah,
you can easily amend the declaration, take out D, vote on that amendment,
yes.
And then vote on my original minus that D.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That's how it would work. Whether Kathy makes it, or Jessica makes it, or I make it, or whoever makes it, it doesn't mean you then support the overarching
right.
motion.
We're
You're
only
just
responding
on
item
1 D.
D
is what we would.
Right.
Right.
So I can even do that. I can amend my motion to remove Section D from the declaration and go from there. We just need a second.
I'll second it. And then we can vote on it.
Now we're going to vote
on
your comment about it.
Yes, please. In my personal opinion, this is ridiculous. We're down to such a level of detail. There are many issues that have come before the council that the people who voted on have a gigantically larger personal impact, like Robinson Woods, people who abutted that land and the implications that had on their life and their property taxes and so forth. The fact that they drive their tractor across a piece of land that's 10 feet long and we're having this conversation and we actually think that somehow Caitlin's going to be swayed by that fact, to me, is so not the way Cape Elizabeth does business. This is a small town. Obviously, it's going to have no impact on her, and to me, this just seems disrespectful.
I appreciate
your
comment.
But that being said, I just want to get that out there. I know we're going to vote on it. It's okay.
Okay.
I just, to me, this is an absurd, distraction.
I appreciate your comment. I do think it's important, given the fact that the council does have a policy on conflicts of interest, that we are very clear about that. We just took a vote and said we were not going to ask Caitlin to recuse as long as we dealt with this particular issue, and I think that's what we're trying to accomplish at this point. Caitlin, did you have a comment?
I just want to comment to Sarah's comment that I think people need to keep in mind that I technically and completely have zero interest in the property. My parents could turn around and sell that parcel tomorrow, which is always up for discussion because house lots can go right on there. So the fact that we always keep coming back to, I have a conflict of interest or a perceived conflict of interest, most conflicts of interest have to do with financial benefit or a perceived financial benefit. I have zero interest, legal interest, in Alwives Brook Farm. I work there, I manage it, I could leave tomorrow and pursue my legal career. I just feel like I'm constantly being attacked for my parents owning a property in this town. That's all. Said my piece.
So we had an amendment. You made an amendment to your
motion.
Prior motion. Did we have a second for that?
I did.
Patty? Kathy?
Now, does that mean that the entire motion is back on the table?
No, we're just voting on
just on item D.
Thank you.
Removal
I wanted to be sure.
Of item 1.1D. Correct?
Thank you.
Any more discussion about removal of 1.1.D? All in favor? Opposed? That does not pass. Okay, so now we are back to Caitlin's original motion, which is to accept the land trust declaration and easement as written by the land trust. Further discussion. Kathy?
Yeah, when it was discussed that we would be jointly identifying and developing projects, and that this gave us a lot of rights, the wording in the event that a decision cannot be reached by the grantor and the grantee, the grantor in its capacity as landowner as a 501c3 nonprofit corporation retains the final authority, we're getting no rights. That sentence right there takes away all those perceived rights, because if there's a disagreement, we're giving them the authority to make the final decision. Considering, I think Jessica said, considering we're giving $75,000 of taxpayer dollars to this project, I will be voting against this because the town's attorney has counseled us that this is not the correct language, that the language is in the second document that is authored by just him, and it doesn't include that sentence. So if there's a perception that we're getting something out of this, my perception is we're not, and I believe that that is also, unless I'm reading Tom Leahy's notes and suggestions, he agrees with that. So I will be voting against this. I think it's disappointing that we're trying to run through this all this evening. I don't know how the council is going to feel about this, but I would like to see it postponed until we can get a little clearer understanding of what it is we're looking at, because this has all been flying around in the last couple days. And I think that I think the town's giving up too much of their rights, so I'll be voting against it.
Thank you, Patty.
I would hope wholeheartedly that we don't postpone this. I think postponing it could potentially jeopardize the gift and the purchase of this property, because we wouldn't be able to start talk about this until the purchase date is over. So I would hope we could sift through this evening and find some type of either adoption of the motion that's here, which I may support with a few questions, or some other version of it, but also giving conceptual agreement that we would go forward. My question, I guess, for Cindy or one of you is, when we talk about in the event of a decision cannot be reached by, you know, the grantor or grantee and those particular issues, and they would not be reached in good faith. Specifically, I heard you guys say that, and you're talking about your 501c3 status. When I sat down and met with you, Cindy, and just talked briefly, you said that that could potentially jeopardize your nonprofit status, your articles of incorporation, and then the land trust accreditation. Is that your biggest issue on the table, like where, is that where the line would go in the sand for you? And what would that look like? What would the events be, is my question. I don't think you're going to get upset over, you know, how a bridge is built, because you either agree or not agree, but you might be upset about where it would be built, and what would be the thing that would drive you to a point of having an issue or a roadblock?
Cindy, would you come up to the microphone to respond, please?
You know, we've definitely had some discussion about this, and to be really honest, we cannot foresee anything right now with the current groups at the town that we would be working with. A potential example down the road is, let's say that the town decided that they really wanted to manage, you know, they wanted to recommend that the property be managed for specific threatened or endangered species, and that required tree removal or some other sort of change to the property. And the land trust really felt, and this is right in all these documents that you're referencing, the articles of incorporation and, you know, other documents, they really felt that they had to manage for the entire ecological system on the property. You know, it's that type of thing that we're talking about, you know? And that's not happening this year, it's not happening next year, you know, but maybe 100 years from now, it could. Or, you know, I don't know, someone wants to sell the trees to make some money. I mean, you know, there's things that we would never do like that, that we just, you know, we know the group here wouldn't push for them. But we don't, with the in perpetuity, it's primarily the in perpetuity piece that we need to require, because that's how we are, you know, able to be an accredited land trust and have a 501c3 status as a land trust. So I, you know, we don't really foresee it coming up, and that's the other thing that I think is really hard here, is that I think, you know, definitely the two things that are really granted to the town are guaranteed public access and guaranteeing conservation of a property that's really critical next to a water body that's of statewide significance. And those two things the town, you know, is getting. So I hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Hold on one second. Patty, did you have another question? A follow-up to that?
Not right this second.
Okay. Thank you. Sarah?
I am going to support this for the following reasons. It seems to me that we are getting a great deal here, and so I'm a little mystified why my other counselors don't perceive it that way. We are paying less than a quarter of this property. I think it's 24%, and for 24%, we're getting an enormous amount. We're getting invited to the, first of all, let's just start by saying this was Selt's property. They've cultivated the relationship for years, I think. They've followed this. They've had their eye on it. They're the ones that stepped out. They did all the legal work. They made the offer. They're offering to do any pay for any infrastructure that needs to be done. For a quarter of the price, they're inviting us to the table to have a voice in every practical matter that's going to come up. It may be that some thing way down the road becomes a loggerhead, and yes, they would get decision making, but why shouldn't they? It's they're going to pay for three quarters of the property. So to me, to walk away from this or even to balk at it seems so unwise. I'm just mystified by people's reticence and feeling that somehow we deserve 50% of everything that goes on in this property. We're not paying 50%. We're not even paying close to that. So to me, this seems like an unbelievable deal. I feel like this has been a gift thrown in our lap, and I couldn't be more thrilled at the prospect of collaborating with the land trust on this whole property that is beautiful. It's an amazing acquisition, and, you know, I think that this going forward could be a great fresh start on, you know, the two of us, these two parties working hand in glove to achieve the mission of both of them. I personally think that we can have all the access that citizens want, and we can preserve what's obviously a valuable and beautiful ecosystem. So I think it's such a win-win that I couldn't be more thrilled to support it.
Thank you. Other comments? Jessica?
The last, that statement, in my opinion, completely negates the entire agreement. It does.
The last statement of paragraph four?
Yeah, in the event that a decision cannot be reached by the grantor and the grantee, the grantor in its capacity as landowner and as a 501(c)(3) retains the final authority to approve any such project. So it effectively can negate the entire agreement. I'd like to address some of the comments made between Ms. Carney and Ms. Crum. And I, you know, I appreciate their time and their efforts. And, you know, it's always good to work collaboratively. I would like to point out a couple things, though. I do appreciate that they want to preserve land in perpetuity, but to suggest that the town of Cape Elizabeth doesn't want the same thing, I bristle a little bit at. I think the town will be here for the next 50 or 500 years. And the town has been a very staunch provider and supporter of public access and guaranteed conservation. So we certainly wear that hat as well as any other entity. And I would like to toot the town's horn for that, because we really do. And I think the town of Cape Elizabeth will be here for a long time. So anyhow, I am not happy with that sentence. I'm prepared to vote for this. I agree with, you know, much of what Councillor Lennon has said. I could support this with the removal of that last sentence, the sentence that I mentioned. So.
Other comments?
I said I would vote against it, yes, as proposed, but I would agree with Councillor Sullivan. If that sentence is removed, I will vote for it. So.
Thank you.
I don't want to.
Caitlin?
Oh, just, I mean, the removal of that sentence just brings it to the other version, the town's version, which has no end decision maker actually in it. What happens in the town's version, if that overall final authority is not put in there, what do we do if there's an impasse? Do we just have good faith negotiations for in perpetuity? I mean, forever going on, there's, you know, the idea that the, and I don't think that the land trust was saying that the town of Cape Elizabeth isn't going to want to, you know, be around and have conservation, but the reality is we answer to a lot more people than the land trust does. So if in 50 years somebody thinks it's a good idea that that piece of property protect more cottontails, and that requires cutting down a bunch of trees, and the town council that's made up at the time agrees that, yeah, that's the most important thing to do, that's what the land trust is saying, is their job is to protect the whole property as a whole, the whole ecological system, and that it might not be the top priority to protect cottontails like the town council is thinking, because they're getting pressured by the town or the state or whoever that they have to answer to. It's just, you have to, this is what their job is, their sole job in this town is to protect land. So why are we trying to micromanage them?
Thank you. Yes, Michael?
Yeah, I'm not speaking for or against. I just feel a responsibility to clarify certain things. And, you know, I've supported this. I've supported giving even more money than the council proposed at one point. But, you know, I've always looked to the land trust to treat the town as they would any other conservation organization. So, you know, if it's a Maine Coast Heritage that they're with or whatever, that the town has an equal footing. As this is proposed, you know, one of the concerns that we've had in the past with some of the different land trust parcels is that there's no absolute guarantee of public access. As this is now drafted and is about to be voted on by the council, the Leahy draft provided that there could be a decision that material affects public access, and it would need to be decided by both parties. As this now stands, the land trust could totally close public access simply by vote of the land trust. If you look at that, if you look at that paragraph of projects, and you look at one of the things, that which material affects public access is listed in that paragraph about projects, those 4 points, and then it goes on to say that it's a sole decision. So there is nothing here that really guarantees public access in the end. And, you know, I still think it's important for the council to contribute this. I think it's important to preserve this land. I think, you know, there's going to be public access, but there is no, I just want everyone to be clear, there is no absolute guarantee in the future that there'll always be public access. The land trust is an independent board, is not elected, meets privately, makes the decisions privately, and, you know, they have the power to do that. You know, they may not totally agree, they're studying the materials, but that was why we proposed that language. All of that said, I'm fine, you know, if with the council majority. I just want you to understand that what you're getting and that what you're not.
Thank you. Question. Jessica, hold on 1 second, Caitlin. Jessica had her hand up first.
Yeah, a couple things that in response to Councilor Jordan, and actually the town manager just touched on it, and that is that when you were talking about, you know, the town might change its mind in 50 years or something, and I suppose that's true. That hasn't been the way so far, but let's just say if it did. Everything the town does is public. That is not the case with the land trust. And so we have to remember that they, as this is being proposed, they could, in one of their private meetings, of course, it's a private entity, make a decision. The town is all, we always have our deliberations in public. And so there would be, I think, if there were to be some bizarre change in the future, there would be tremendous public debate because we are public. That is not the situation with the land trust. I would also like to remind the council that our town attorney is recommending that we not accept this. We have a town attorney, and he is recommending that we not accept this with that statement. Isn't that correct?
Would you like to clarify that, Michael?
Am I incorrect?
No, the town attorney in his last email on this topic said it's a matter of public policy for the council to determine which of the two versions that they're willing to accept. He did not explicitly say not to accept the land trust version.
All right, I stand corrected.
I think what he implied was that the version that he had proposed responded more directly to what the issues were that were raised by the council at last month's
meeting. That's correct.
Did you have another question?
No.
Thank you. Caitlin.
Just so the other version without this sentence in the town's version has the same number 3, to adopt use restrictions that would have a material impact on public access, but it's lacking the final decision maker.
Right.
And also, according to this contract, it states that we'll have good faith negotiations, which means that the land trust cannot just go in behind a closed door and decide they're just going to cancel public access. We can then sue them for breach of contract and for not having good faith negotiations, which they're not. So that's not a viable option of what can happen. Yes, they can decide to do something after they've had good faith negotiations and they've had public input, because if they're having good faith negotiations, then they have the town at the table and it has to be public. But that doesn't solve, you go back to the language of number 3, it's still in there with the town's version, but who gets to have the final say if there's no good faith negotiations? Where do the good faith negotiations lead to with the public access?
Yeah.
And one more thing, we directed the town attorney to develop this document based on what the Conservation Commission asked for. So Tom Leahy is not forcing this down your throat. He's just saying, this is what you asked for, so this is what I delivered. So it's not that he's saying we shouldn't go with the town. He's just saying, you asked me to take this position, so I've taken this position, and that's the position he's in. So it's unfortunate that he's not here tonight.
Michael, did you have
something? Yeah, I just, again, you know, I don't mean to be argumentative on any of this. It you know, there was nothing in the Leahy document that would force the land trust to do anything. that would, you know, the town couldn't go down, couldn't go in and unilaterally cut trees down. There was none of that stuff that could happen unless both parties agree. And, you know, the sense that somehow, you know, the town was going to need some money and want to harvest trees or do whatever, you know, there was nothing in the agreement that would have allowed us to do that. And I just want to make that clear as well.
Thank you. Jamie?
So I just want to be clear, Mike, based on what you said, that, you know, one of the town's primary goals is preserving access, you know, not only preserving open space, but preserving the public access.
Yep.
And based on what I heard you just say, neither of these does that. Neither of these provides for that guarantee. So the point that we're making about, and has been debated about, whether or not it's a shared, the grantee and the grantor agreeing on these different facets, neither one of these versions assures what should be the primary objective if we're doing this kind of thing, and that's guaranteeing public access. So what I would question is whether or not there's some way to achieve that language, you know, the sentence that we're disagreeing about notwithstanding, because that seems to be the ultimate purpose and goal, not who gets ultimate decision making.
But. Would you like to respond to that?
Yeah, just I'm sorry to interrupt your discussion, but because there's just been looking just at that paragraph with the four itemized things, but if you look at the sentence immediately above that, the last line of that paragraph says, the grantor and grantee agree that public access will always be protected on the premises. And then the paragraph below itemizes specific types of decisions, but the overarching proposition is the immediately prior sentence, and I don't know if you can see here where the grantor and grantee agree that public access will always be protected on the premises. And if you can see that, again, even in the first paragraph, the purpose of providing the property is being conserved and the easement is being granted for the purpose of providing access thereto by the general public for non-motorized low-impact outdoor recreation without fee. So there's a lot in this document that guarantees public access. The issue that the council is focusing on, these four itemized things, are different sort of subsets of public access, like where trails are going to be located, how bridges are going to be designed. But the general overarching proposition of public access, that is guaranteed. And so thank you for allowing me to bring that.
Thank you. Jamie, did you have another question?
I did. I was curious, and I don't know if anybody has the answer to this tonight, if this language, as it is in the land trust's version, is similar or nearly identical to language from previous land trust acquisitions that the town has gifted money to.
Michael?
You know, it's similar. You know, I think, you know, what happened was, back around when Robinson Woods 2 was done, there was a lot of concern within the council in terms of the language and what was achieved and was not achieved. The public spoke out with a lot of concern, particularly about dogs and some of those issues. And, you know, it was left afterward, and the council said at the time that they wanted, in the next time there was a donation, to essentially do a better job of it. And what we were looking for this time was trying to come up with a template that might be the standard that might be used in the future. Because, you know, we've always, on the major acquisitions, most of the major acquisitions, with one exception, we have contributed about a one-third of the dollar amount. You know, it's hoped that will continue in the future. And, you know, this isn't quite one-third, though. This is closer to 25%, I think. It's hoped that there might be a template so there'd be consistent language in the future. And this was an attempt to look at some of the issues that had come up during Robinson Woods 2. And I might also say the Conservation Commission, you know, came out with a proposal And it basically said, you know, well, anything we have the right to, you know, full joint decision-making. And the Leahy proposal tried to frame that into just those four items instead of carte blanche for everything. But essentially, you know, most of the language is very similar, but, you know, we haven't had the language, to my knowledge, that Bob Danielson, their attorney, is proposing in the end here.
Other comments? Yes. Yes, Sarah.
I just want to clarify that, you know, this conversation has sort of meandered into a place where it's sort of appearing like CELT isn't into public access, and I think of that as one of their core missions. I mean, when they acquire land, they acquire it essentially for two purposes: to preserve valuable land and ecosystems, and to allow the public to enjoy it to the maximum that they're able to allow it without destroying what may be an endangered species or whatever. And, you know, when that happens, they just find another way to go around it, like the field on Robinson Woods too. Okay, they made a path through the trail. The disagreement you're referring to, Mike, you know, they've now come to the table and they've hashed out a solution, which they're changing it. So to me, they show every sign of accommodating the town's requests if they perceive, you know, any public access to be being limited in any way. So I'm just afraid that we've gone off on a trajectory where we're sort of saying, oh, the Land Trust doesn't want public access, and, you know, we don't care about sensitive ecosystems. I think, you know, if you made a Venn diagram, our interests are about 90% overlap, and in the highly unlikely event that the 2% appears, I agree with Caitlin that it's not really a legal decision to say, well, you guys just work it out if you're having a problem. I mean, that's essentially what the Leahy document says, like, sit down at the table and figure it out. Well, what if you can't? I mean, I hope that will never arise, but in the end, most legal findings say this person is the decider. You know, this person can be the decider if this should ever arise, which hopefully it never will. And again, I go back to, they're the much bigger owner of it. We're just a small piece here. And so, you know, I just don't want to run the risk of losing our part of it entirely. I mean, we back out of this and then we have no say at the table. I think that would be very unfortunate.
Patty.
To Ann Carney's point, the line that she's pointing out, which I was going to say earlier, is where it says the grantor and grantor agrees that public access will always be protected on the premises. And to Caitlin's point, that in for some reason they decide, and I think what we're operating out of these worst case fear scenarios on both sides of what could possibly happen, like because we have two competing things. One, the town's is public access, and CELT is preservation. And we're both taking the worst case scenario and trying to protect ourselves. And the worst case for the town that CELT might come through is just say, you get to walk to 20 feet in and look over a bridge, and that's it now. So we've closed everything off for protection. But I do think, to Caitlin's point, that if they're in good faith negotiations, if they were to be a decision maker, if we left and approved this, that we would have a case to make that there's, in the contract, it says here, that the public access will always be protected on the premises. And maybe, I mean, at the very least, I would hope that we could approve this, and perhaps if we do end up, the very least, voting this down, if that happens, probably some other longer or better third possibility thing where both people could come back to the table and come up with something that's agreeable by both attorneys, but making sure that we guarantee that there'll be a, you know, gift made. So, you know, this is a tough one, but I guess I would, my first instinct is to support and approve the motion that's on the table currently.
Thank you. Anyone else? Just ask him. Yes, Michael?
I support this. I'm not being, you know, I just try to protect 10 years from now. People can look at this tape, what happened, what was the discussion, have an understanding of it. So you look at this, and I'm going to use Land Trust in town instead. The town and the Land Trust agree that public access will always be protected on the premises. The parties shall jointly identify and develop projects with regard to the premises that pertain to public access, and that such matters as the decisions, and I'm skipping down to three, to adopt use restrictions as would have a material impact on public access. It said it should be discussed, but then it says, the Land Trust, in its capacity as the nonprofit corporation retains the final authority. And that's, if you look at its entirety, you know, you just need to, you know, need to understand that, you know, good faith, we're going to have public access. It's $75,000, but there's not 100% guarantee that one of the parties won't adopt use restrictions that would have a material impact on public access.
Thank you. Yes, Jessica?
Yeah, I just wanted to repeat my concern that that sentence risks public access. It certainly could, and the council's got to be really aware of that. There, we recently had a situation, in fact, Cindy Crum alluded to that, more than alluded to that. The Conservation Commission had built an agreed-upon trail in Robinson Woods 2, done all the work, and then the Land Trust changed the location of the trail because an abutting property owner complained and didn't like it. Now, they have since worked it out, but the change was made. And so it's just an illustration. It has, I think, a very happy ending now. But there are no, what I want to point out is there are no guarantees. There just aren't. You know, and I certainly have faith that all will work out. But that last sentence makes me very, very nervous. If we could remove that, I would be very happy to support this.
Thank you. Any other comments? No? Kathy?
Ditto.
I'm sorry?
Ditto. Remove the last sentence.
Anything else? No. I will just say, I like to think of myself as a fiscal conservative. And having said that, I really want to give the $75,000 to the Land Trust. I think this is a tremendous investment for the community for the long term. I think it's the right thing to do. I think it's adjacent to land that we have access to. There's a water body downstream. I don't think that we want to see any further development on that site with the potential for runoff to Great Pond. I think this is the place we want to be putting $75,000. Having said that, I too cannot vote for this language as it exists right now. I think our town attorney has been quite clear, and I think Michael has raised the point at least three times, that the way that this document is currently written, that last sentence of paragraph 4 negates everything else that comes before it, or has the potential to negate everything that comes before it. So while I will vote in favor, or I don't need to vote in favor because I think the council did this last month in favor of spending the $75,000, I cannot vote in favor of the motion that's on the table right now. Having said that, unless anyone else has any other comments, are we prepared to vote? Yes? No? Sorry?
I was just going to ask
Jessica
through you if the town clerk would repeat the motion on the table.
Yes.
The motion, as I understand it, goes back to the original motion by Councilor Jordan, seconded by Councilor Garvin, to accept the proposed declaration and to accept the Land Trust version of the public access easement drafted by R. Danielson, dated July 8th, 2016.
Thank you. Jamie, did you have another question?
I just had a question, cognizant of the timing, of the closing of the property, what opportunity there may or may not be to further come to some sort of consensus, given that we won't have another council meeting until after the proposed closing date. I'm just curious about some of the alternative options, since I think in spirit, all of us agree on the value of this opportunity, and we're, you know, as Sarah said, more than 90% there, trying to figure out a way to avoid throwing out the baby with the bathwater here. So, I don't know.
Michael?
Yeah, this agreement is 95% of the way there. It's just that one sentence, but up to this point, the parties have not been able to agree, and there's been no hint that the Land Trust is you know, if you look at the you haven't seen all the emails, but you know, at one point they said they didn't want to negotiate anymore, And then we came up with some additional language. We negotiated a little bit more, and this is what we came up with. You know, I think you got to look at the overall conservation goals and trust amongst the parties, and you know, understanding that this is not what some wanted. But your direct question of the council could have a special meeting. You could, you know, you yourselves could go negotiate with the land trust. You know, it's endless, you know, what the possibilities are. But, you know, I do think that this was a good faith negotiation. And, you know, you have two proposals before you, and there's a motion on the table for one, and you ought to consider it.
Okay, fine.
Just further to Jamie's question, I mean, it's very possible that we can vote this down and the land trust and the town won't come to agreement and the town gets nothing. We get to keep our $75,000, but we have no seat at the table, no decision rights. The land trust could decide just to conserve the property and not open it up to any public access. I mean, not that they want to, but it would be their legal right. So I'm just, even if we go back to the drawing table, we basically have three options. We can give final decision making to land trust. We can keep it ambiguous as it is in the town's version where nobody has final decision making and no final decisions could potentially ever be made. Or you could somehow get the land trust to agree to let the town have final decision making for their 24% of the purchase price, which I highly doubt will happen. So as I view it, are our options. We get a seat at the table, we get to have good faith negotiations and all decision making, but in the mere chance that one of these extreme cases that Patty was talking about happens, the land trust gets to have the final decision because they own 75% of the property, or they own the property, but they put up 75% of the money.
So I think we should vote. We've all said our say. We all know the issues, let's just vote.
Any other comments? No? Deb, could you read us the motion one more time? We are voting in favor of?
To accept the proposed declaration and to accept the land trust version of the public access easement drafted by R. Danielson, dated July 8th, 2016.
Great.
Point of information, we are excluding the language on D, though, right?
Wasn't that? No,
I think
D
we voted
is
that down.
We already did.
That's still in.
It's still in.
Always to keep it.
We voted, but.
Yeah,
I lost.
Right, okay. Yep, thanks. I lost track of that.
All those in favor? Opposed? That motion passes. Thank you for the council for that lengthy debate. Thank you for the land trust folks. And if I could just say, I hope that this leads to a very long and collaborative relationship between the Conservation Commission and other town bodies and the land trust, and that this sets the tone for all future relationships between the land trust and the Conservation Commission. I see it potentially to be a template for a very successful long-term relationship. I hope you can work it out. Yes.
Thank you so much for all your work on this.
Thank you. Okay. We will move on to item number 99-2016, Thomas Memorial Library Operational Procedures Amendment Process. Mike, would you like to introduce this item?
Yeah, the library has a procedures manual, sometimes referred to as a policy manual, and the council's been getting a bunch of recommendations to amend it on such things as pamphlet racks and procedures in the gaming room and activities in the community room. These are reviewed by the trustees of the Thomas Memorial Library, and then they come directly to the council. In looking at it, you know, they get delayed, they get, you know, it's just not in my view, it's not a good procedure. I'm proposing that they still be reviewed by the Thomas Memorial Library committee. No change in the past, except they would then come to whoever is the town manager at any given point, and the town manager approve them, and they go into the manual.
Thank you. So we're looking for a motion to return the administration of the library to the intent of the charter and the administrative code, and proposals involving departmental regulations and performance of department's business, etc. Would someone like to make that motion? Kathy?
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second? Thank you, Patty. Discussion on that. I see we still have folks here from the library, Board of, the Thomas Memorial Library Committee.
It's still the trustees.
Are they?
Everybody is.
Sorry. And we also have a representative from the TML Foundation Board as well. Would anyone like to speak to this?
I guess I'm really confused, because you're just referring to the town charter, and the town charter refers to a board of trustees for the Thomas Memorial Library, but now you're the trustees for the Thomas Memorial Library. And so I guess I'm really unclear of when you talk about who's who. It really begs the question of some clarity, since you are now the board, the trustees.
Thank you.
Similarly, I would just like to add that in section three.
Hold on. One second. You hold that second thought, and we'll let Michael respond to your question.
This was written on June 22nd at the time. That other one hadn't passed. It's the full intent that it be the Thomas Memorial Library Committee. And if you look back at what the council adopted earlier, it is part of the charge of that committee to review library procedures. So it's exactly that the council, in its capacity as a council and as a board, will not be involved in this going forward.
Did you have a second question?
I'm just really concerned about the town charter and the represent that you are now the board of trustees, and in the town charter it says that you can fire people who are on the board of trustees because of their performance if there's due cause. And so that in fact suggests that you can terminate each other because you're now the board of trustees. And so I guess my concern is that the charter no longer is reflective of what's really taking place in the town, and I would really encourage the town council to take on the town charter and revise it so that it is transparent and reflective of what's really happening in the town. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
That's exactly what this item is attempting to do, is to follow the spirit, the intent, and the letter of the town charter. It's exactly what this item is intending to do.
Thank you. Any other comments, questions, discussion? Anyone else from the public would like to speak? No? You can come up. Good. Well, you need to come up to the microphone for the folks who are
I'm
watching
at home. I'm still with Ann Haley, and I live on Brentwood Road. I still am a little bit confused about all of this language that everyone's proposing, because I think Caitlin mentioned that you are now you have elected yourself as Board of Trustees to avoid a vote on the charter. That's concerning to me, because as Debbie said, we want to be very transparent and have the charter reflect exactly what's going on in the town. And it just seems a little bit convoluted, even though it's well-intentioned. So, you know, I go back to, you know, that the Board of Trustees recommends replacements for the foundation, and the language now doesn't match. When I go through my bylaws on my lap, we need to rewrite them all because of what you've done tonight. And again, the charter requires a vote, and you've avoided it by what you've done tonight.
Thank you. Yeah, just a reminder, but one of the items that was referred to the council workshop is to review all of the different documents to be sure that the adjustments are made in conformance with language. And
right.
It's
all related documents describing the purpose and duties of the committee should be updated to be consistent with the ordinance. This should include the website descriptions, committee member orientation materials, and other items. So I think the intent of that will be to address your specific concerns.
Molly?
Yes.
And just real quick, in the new ordinance, there's bylaws, standard bylaws written for all the committees, so there's no need for each individual committee to have its own standing bylaws.
Okay. Thank you. Any other discussion on this item? Are we ready to vote? All in favor of item number 99, 2016, motion on the table. Any opposed? No? That passes unanimously. Thank you. We'll move on to item number 100-2016, the poll location approval process. Mike, would you like to introduce this item?
Yes. This is in keeping with a lot of other actions and work that the town's council's been working on this evening, and that's updating longstanding practices that have had the council deal with minutia when you ought to be dealing with policy and larger issues. One of them is poll locations. The Public Works Director approves all excavations. He approves, all things that go into the right-of-way, with the one exception of poll locations. And the statute, 35 MRSA 2503, paragraph 21, provides that the town council may designate someone as the local licensing authority for poll locations. So I'm proposing that you designate the Public Works Director. And that also has a review board.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, if a poll went in and someone didn't like the location, then it could actually be reviewed by the council. But you know, you look at this next one we have, we got the application. Fairpoint received it before May 27th, and it isn't being considered by the council until, what is it, July 9th,
11th.
July 11th tonight. You know, and it just takes way too long.
Mm-hmm.
So this would streamline it, give much better service to customers, but yet still give the ability of the council to be a review board for any decisions.
Thank you. Do I have a motion? Jessica?
I so move.
Thank you. A second? Kathy? Thank you. Discussion? No? I would just like to say I think we are headed in the right direction in terms of making this a more efficient practice, both for you and the council, but also for the community involved. You're right. Waiting 6 weeks for an approval on a poll location is not right. Yes, Caitlin?
Quick question. When would this take effect? As soon as possible?
If this is approved, I would suggest you table the next item.
Or can we take them out of order?
Whatever, you could take them out of order, you could refer item 101 to the Public Works Director.
I would ask if we could make a point of order to take them out of order so we can move these people's approval right along.
I like that idea conceptually. Can we do that since we already have a motion on the table?
You could suspend the rules in order to do that with a two-thirds vote.
I'm sorry, what are you saying? That you wanted to say that to use the new
yes.
system with this one?
No,
we if want we to give vote, the approval tonight.
Okay.
On this
if
one.
We vote right now, then
got
Bob
it, got
has
it, got
to
it,
approve
got it.
This.
Sorry,
if we
I wasn't
take
listening
the next item first,
got it.
Then we can approve it, they can be done, and then we can change the policy
I
right
see.
After.
Do you need a motion to suspend the rules?
Yes.
I mean that we suspend the rules.
Thank you. Is there a second on that?
Second. Second.
Thank you, Caitlin. All in favor of suspending the rules and therefore moving item number 101 ahead of item number 100. All in favor? Any discussion? I'm sorry. All in favor? Any opposed? No? Okay. So now we are introducing item number 101. Caitlin, did
I
you want
to? I move we approve the poll location at Shore Road, approximately 550 feet southeasterly of Dyer Pond Road.
Thank you. Is there a second for that motion? Thank you, Jamie. Any discussion? All in favor? Any opposed? No? Wonderful. That motion passes unanimously. We will move back to item number 100. And do we have a motion on the table already for item number 100 if we suspended the rules? Do we need to make that motion over again? That's what
we just
really
take
asking.
A motion up.
No, I think we're okay.
I think we have the motion made.
We have a motion.
All you need to say is that motion, we consider that motion to be on the table, and it is on the table.
Thank
all
you.
Powerful.
I consider that motion to be on the table. There it is. Any discussion? We had a second on that, correct?
Yes.
Thank you. Any discussion? Any further discussion? No. All in favor on item number 100. Any opposed? No, that passes unanimously. Thank you. And Michael, item number 102, proposed carry-forward balances. Give us an update on that.
Yeah, each year at the July meeting, we ask you to authorize certain carry-forward balances. In the most cases, they're the exact balance, although this year we rounded them off to the nearest $100 that was left in the account. I would like to point out that there are, as there are every year, there are a couple of things that have been added to the list as during the budget, since the budget process, we've identified certain needs, issues that come up. Let me start at the bottom. Winter moth tree removal and replacement. I think as everyone is aware, we have a serious issue with winter moth starting to eat trees, and we're going to have a public forum on that. It's clear we're probably going to have to do some tree removals in the right-of-way where there's dead trees that are dangerous. That costs money. What I'd like to do is to set up a, you know, this could be something that could cost us hundreds of thousands of dollars in the next few years. So what I'd like to do is at least start by having a fund that would enable the tree warden to address the immediate hazards of dead trees and also replace trees. You might notice we just did a few here in the town center this past week. Mm-hmm. We're also going to be considering a very we're going to be asking the public, do they want us to do a very limited program of treatment? The public may not want that. We need to find out if they want it or not. For example, we treated the tree on Scott Dyer Road this year on the middle school property with notices to the schools and posting and all the different rules so that tree didn't die. It's a tree that everyone loves and adores. We also did the little trees out here. You know, do we want to go down and do the ones along the right-of-way of Old Ocean House Road or Mitchell Road or whatever? I don't know if the public wants that done. They're pesticides. But, you know, many other towns are doing it. I'm not sure if we want to do it or not, but at least this would give an ability to experiment with that if the citizens want it. But the main focus of this is to, and that would come back to the council, obviously, the main focus of this is removal of dead trees that we know are starting to get hit in the right-of-way from because of the winter moth. The one above that, any questions on that?
Do we have a proposed date for that forum?
Hmm?
Do we have a proposed date for that public input session?
The tree warden is working with, actually, the Cape Elizabeth Garden Club planning it, and there's a date in August, and I just don't remember. You don't know when that is, Deb, do you? You don't know when that is? No, I don't know when it is. But it's in August sometime.
I think Jessica had
a
question.
It's Beach to Beacon week, which I wasn't too happy about, but it is during that week, and I think it's that Tuesday night of Beach to Beacon week.
Okay. Thank you. Jessica, hold on. Jessica, did you have a question?
Yeah, I had a comment on the winter moth tree removal.
Yeah.
You know, I'm glad to see that. I live on Mitchell Road now, and I'm probably going to be having to take down three trees.
Hmm.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking this is going to be a big, already is townwide problem, most likely.
Big and expensive.
Yeah, and, you know, it would be a shame to forego the opportunity to save a lot of trees on town property, if we can.
Did we have another question on that item? Sarah?
My question is, how do you know when they're dead? Because I have the same issue on our property, and I had Kevin Bosworth looked at it, and he said, sometimes they can come back and recover because the moth thing goes in cycles.
Yep.
So he's like, this looks like it's dead, but
yeah,
next year it might be okay, and it might not. So how are you going to wait a year? How are you going to know when it's dead?
Oh, a tree warden is a licensed arborist.
Okay.
And he has that expertise.
So he'll say, this one is not going to make it. This one might.
It's not me looking at it. It's the licensed arborist who believes in all cases of trying to save trees.
Okay.
That's his bias.
Okay, great.
Yeah. No.
Okay.
Pool rust and mold stainless steel. If anyone's been in the women's locker room lately, it's disgraceful, all of the rust and the on all the stainless steel and what looks like mold and whatever. And we're going to replace those all out with like a plastic, you know, like you see stalls in restrooms, as opposed to that stainless steel that is just has become hideous. The mirrors, the men's room has similar problems. The shower, stainless steel of the where it goes up against the wall, it just looks awful, and it's maybe unhealthy. So we want to go in and deal with that. The preschool playground that's been used by the preschool kids, Cape Care kids, that's all fallen apart. They didn't have any money to do it. And community service miscellaneous supplies, when I met with all the staff there recently, they just haven't had money to deal with odds and ends. And when I looked at their budget, they actually this year ran a surplus of about $90,000. So this is really investing their surpluses back into things for community services, the miscellaneous supplies, the playground, and the pool, those three items. Any questions on those? No, and the final one is the town hall meeting spaces, open spaces plan. That is, we've been looking for a while at doing a renovation, which we haven't done in a couple of decades up front. It was all designed during the typewriter era. And there was $75,000 in the account I'm proposing. We boosted it to $125,000. The others are all routine. The monies are there, no issues, unless anyone has any questions. But I like to disclose all of those that are new.
Yes, Sarah?
Just for the sake of the public, can you, when I read roadway and drainage, I'm like, wow, why is that such a big item? Can you, is that actually paving?
It is.
Just what, okay, so when someone sees a road being repaved, you call it roadway and drainage?
That's right.
Okay.
Roadway and drainage, most of it's paving, but we also do small drainage projects as well. We're trying to get one down on Hemlock Hill Road now. And, you know, and it's the typical paving program. And, you know, you go in and do a Mitchell Road or, a, you know, it can easily be, you know, $150,000, $200,000.
Right.
Mike, I was just going to add that it is August 2nd, Tuesday, August 2nd, from 7 to 8 at the library.
Okay, thank you.
That meeting
thank you.
For the winter.
It was the Tuesday, August 2nd?
Yep.
It's in the community room at the library at 7?
7 o'clock, yep. There's details on the Thomas Memorial Library website.
Well, that's great. Thank you. So could I have a motion on this item to approve the carry forward balance? Sarah?
I move we approve the carry forward balance.
Thank you. Is there a second for that motion?
A second.
Thank you, Jessica. Any further discussion? No? All in favor? Any opposed? Nope, passes unanimously. We will move on to item number 103-2016, the election clerk appointments. And Deborah, are you introducing this item?
Yeah, absolutely, great. Thank you. One of the election laws requires the municipal offices to look at a list of potential election clerks and also the recommendation of the clerk for a warden. The election clerks are done on the even-numbered years. The term of office is 2 years and until a successor is appointed and qualified. So I would recommend tonight that the town council approves a recommendation of the town clerk for Sharon Gower to continue as warden and Victoria Gilman and Deborah Lane to serve as deputy wardens and until successors are sworn, and that the Capelessville town council approves the list of residents who may be considered to serve as election clerks for the town of Cape Elizabeth for a period of 2 years in until successors are sworn. I'd also like to say that if there are folks on this list that are unable to work an election or what have you, we can go off the list to fill the vacancies needed to run an election. So we do have that. The law does that allow for that flexibility. So.
Okay, thank you. So I would like to entertain a motion as just read by our town clerk.
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second? Thank you, Jessica. Discussion? I just have one. Oh, yes.
I was just going to express my gratitude for all these people in their service.
Thank you. I have one quick question for you, Deb, and that says on the background, right at the top of the page, municipal officers shall appoint election clerks no later than May 1st. Have we met that requirement? And
we did not this year. The time slipped away, but because the terms are to serve until successors are sworn, we were all set.
We're covered.
June 14th. We're okay. All covered. Yes.
Thank you. Great. All in favor? Any opposed? No. That motion passes unanimously. Yes, Michael.
Yeah, I've got a real quick item if the council chair and council would allow. We've received in the mail yesterday the Maine Municipal Association ballot for their election of vice president and executive committee members. There's they have a nominating process. The period for writing candidates has already expired, so there's people running unopposed, and I just think it'd be nice if you authorized the clerk to cast the ballot on behalf of the town. The proposed vice president is Linda Cohen, a councillor for the city of South Portland. She would become the president after being vice president. And there's three directors, the town managers of Easton, Bethel, and Vassalboro, none of whom I know. But anyway, if you could authorize the clerk to cast that ballot on behalf of you, that would be great.
Could I have a motion to do that? So moved. Thank you. Second? Thank you. All in favor? Oh, sorry. Any discussion? All in favor? Any opposed? No? That passes unanimously. I'll hand that to you. Thank you. We are at the end of our items on the agenda. I see that we have no citizens left in the room to give us any other input. So at this point, I will be looking for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Thank you, Kathy. Is there a second? Thank you, Patty. All in favor? That passes unanimously. Thank you, everyone. Good night.